Hello, my name is Frédéric Achard. I am a research scientist with the Joint Research Center based in northern Italy. Today you will learn about module 2.1 of the GovSeagold Red Plus sourcebook. This module is dealing with monitoring activity for forest using from remote sensing. This module is linked to section 2.1 of the GovSeagold sourcebook and to section 3.2, which is giving overview of existing forest area change monitoring systems with country examples of Brazil, India and Central Africa. You have to note that the GovSeagold Red sourcebook has been updated in 2015. You have also to take in account as background material an FCC Paris Agreement in December 2015, and there's also UNFCCC Secretariat has edited a Red Plus Decision Booklet in 2014, which is available on the UNFCCC website. The method and guidance for the Global Forest Observation Initiative, GFOI, has been updated in October 2016. As a second version. As the outline of the lecture, an introduction on forest cover monitoring in the context of UNFCCC will be given shortly at the beginning. Then the presentation will concentrate on sections 2 to 4, which will present the state of the art for data and approaches to be used for monitoring forest area change at national scale in tropical countries from satellite remote sensing imagery. And finally, in section 5, the major limitations of using satellite data will be briefly highlighted. So first, as an introduction, we can give some background on the IPCC requirements for measuring and reporting change in forest area. The activities to reduce emissions from deforestation and forest degradation, or to enhance forest carbon stocks in developing countries, have been included in the Paris Agreement. In this context, the IPCC methodologies and UNFCCC reporting principles have already been identified as the basis for the future Red Plus activities. Methodological issues need to be addressed in order to produce estimates that are comparable. It means that results-based, demonstrable, transparent, and verifiable, and estimated consistently over time. The IPCC guidelines describe three different approaches for representing the activity data, which means the change in area of different land categories. The first approach, approach one, identifies the total area for each land category, typically from non-spatial country statistics, but does not provide information on the nature and area of conversion between land uses. It means that it provides only net change areas, deforestation minus forestation. And thus this approach, approach one, is not suitable for Red Plus. Approach two involves tracking on land cover conversions between categories, resulting in a non-spatially explicit land use conversion matrix. Approach 3 extends approach 2 by using spatially explicit land conversion information derived from either sampling or wall-to-wall mapping techniques. Under Red Plus, land use change need to be identifiable and traceable in the future, which means that only approach 3 or can be used for Red Plus implementation, or alternatively, approach 2 with additional information on land use dynamics. For reference, note that the GFOI method and guidance document has an example of this decision tree for the selection of the tier and approach to be used. Remote sensing, which refers to data acquired by sensors either on board aircraft or space-based platforms, is often the only practical solution for national forest area monitoring in tropical or developing countries. Remote sensing techniques can be used to monitor change in forest areas, it means from forest to non-forest land, which is called deforestation, or from non-forest to forest land, which is called reforestation. The techniques to monitor change in forest areas such as deforestation provide high accuracy activity data, which means area estimates, and can allow reducing the uncertainty of emission factors through spatial mapping of the main forest ecosystems. Monitoring of forestation area has a greater uncertainty than monitoring deforestation. This is because deforestation normally causes a sudden and no clearly noticeable change in remote sensing data or spectral answers, while forestation is typically a slower and more gradual process. In terms of issue affecting the selection and the implementation of monitoring approach, you have to note that there is no single solution for nationwide forest monitoring. Optimal solutions vary depending on national circumstances. In this slide, typical issues affecting the selection and implementation process of the remote sensing methods are listed. Ideally, an optimal combination of methods needs to be found so that a scientifically credible national assessment can be technically accomplished by in-country experts. An hybrid approach combining automated digital segmentation or classification techniques with visual interpretation or validation of the resulting class should be preferred as a simple, robust, and cost-efficient method. From the second section, we will present the way to select the monitoring approach. Approach for monitoring change of forest area will be described, and general recommendation to for the steps to be taken will be given. First, in terms of required activity data, depending on national decisions on the approach to be used, the following some maps can be maybe useful for reporting on the change in forest cover. But it has to be noted that usually a sample of reference data need to be combined with the forest map which can only will be used as a stratification. More detailed information on steps to combine a sample of reference data with wall-to-wall maps is given later in the uncertainty analysis and also in the chapter 5 of the GFY methods and guidance document. Entitled this chapter 5 is entitled Emission Estimation and Uncertainty. In the first step, a definition has to be selected by the country. The definition FAO uses a definition which is indicated in the slides, and that definition comes from the Forest Resource Assessment Programs, in particular the FRA 2010 and the FRA 2015. The selection of the value of crown cover area, tree height, and minimum area for the Kyoto Protocol must be done with the understanding that young stands that have not reached yet the necessary cover or tree height are included as forest, its potential thresholds. Subcategories of forest, it means forest types, can be defined within the framework. Within the framework definition of forest. First, it has to be noted that there's no currently no agreement of a forest or non-forest definition under REDD plus. Countries can choose their own forest definition as long as they clearly describe the definition and are compatible with the UNFCCC and IPCC guidelines. We have to note also that remote sensing imagery allows land cover to be observed, but local field information is needed to derive land use categories which are recommended under the IPCC guidances. Many types of land cover exist usually within national country boundaries. The REDD plus monitoring needs to cover all forest areas, and the same area needs to be monitored for each reporting period. For the first element of red plus, which is related to deforestation, it means a decrease in forest area. It will not be is not necessary or practical in many cases to monitor the entire national extent. That includes also non-forest land types. Therefore, in this case, in the first step, a forest max can be designated initially to identify the area to be monitored for each reporting period. This is specifically referred in the GovSeagold source book as the benchmark mask. So remote sensing data serve a key role not only in mapping current forest cover, but also in establishing historical deforestation rates. The optical mid-resolution data, it means around 20 to 50 meter resolution, have been the primary tool for deforestation monitoring. The USA, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA of the USA, has provided Landsat data series, which goes back to the up to the 70s. Currently, the Landsat 8 continue to deliver images of every location of the world in a 16-day intervals. Data from LIDAR and radar have been shown to be useful in project studies, but so far they have not widely been used operationally for forest monitoring over large areas. In addition to the spatial and temporal resolution and financial issues, one important aspect to take into account in selection of remote sensing data is the seasonality of the climate. In the situation where seasonal forest types exist, more than one scene should be used per year. This table provides a list of current optical sensors at different resolutions, which can be used for deforestation monitoring. In terms of medium resolution satellite imagery, almost complete global coverage from Landsat satellites for the early 90s, early 2000s, around year 2005, around year 2010, and now from the year 2013, are available for free download through web portals at the US Geological Survey. So it means that with Landsat type around years 2000, 2005, 2010, and 2015 will be considered as the most suitable to assess historical rates and patterns of deforestation. Alternative sources of such data, mid-resolution data, includes ASTER, SPOT, IRS, CBERS, DMC, Avenir 2, or RapidEye data. For continuity of Landsat type data, Landsat 8, OLI, and Sentinel 2 MSI sensors play an important role since recent few years. It has to be noted that coarse resolution satellite imagery, 250 meter resolution or larger, cannot be used directly to estimate area of forest change. However, in case of large clearings or rapid change, analysis of coarse resolution data can be used to identify hotspots of forest area or forest area change, which can also help in designing a sampling strategy. This slide is an example of an overall view of a subset of a zoom of a composite image built from a 1 kilometer spatial resolution spot vegetation image acquired around the year 2000. This mosaic was then further clustered using unsupervised clustering algorithm into 60 clusters, which were then assigned into 9 land cover classes, using and available information from the field, from satellite image, and from existing maps through visual interpretation. And the results of this process is shown in the next slide, which shows the final forest cover map created from this spot vegetation composite image. Another example here is shown for forest cover mapping using Landsat imagery at 30 meter resolution with an example of a site in Brazil. In this case, the mapping is based on semi-automated approach starting with image segmentation and followed by initial classification using the land cover signature database. The methodology which has been used to do that is described a bit more in the next slides and in the accompanying exercise documents. The countries can decide to for a wall-to-wall approach or a sampling approach. Brazil and India have already demonstrated that operational wall-to-wall system can be established over very large areas based on Landsat type of imagery, or in the case of India, it's IRS, Indian Remote Sensing Satellite. Brazil has measured deforestation rates in the Brazilian Amazon since the end of the 80s, and these methods can be easily adapted to cope with smaller country sizes. Global wall-to-wall maps of tree cover and tree cover gain and losses over the period 2000-2013, between 2000 and 2013, were published at the end of 2013, with accuracies reported greater than 80% from tropical and subtropical domain. It has to be noted that recommended sampling is more efficient for large countries and is needed to produce more accurate estimates of activity data. Examples of stratified sampling approaches for forest area exchange estimation have been implemented already at over the tropical belt or at national level, with examples in Gabon and Guyana in particular. To illustrate the systematic and stratified sampling, this image illustrates two types of this such sampling, systematic on the left versus stratified on the right. Systematic sampling obtains sample sites over sample units over a regular grid, for example every 10 km or every 100 km. Sampling efficiency can be improved through spatial stratification, which is called stratified sampling, using non-proxy variable, like for example the global tree cover loss map. It has to be noted that proxy variables for stratification can be derived from coarser resolution satellite data or by combining over georeference or map information such as distance to roads or settlements, previous deforestation and factors like FARIS. Now we continue with the section 3 of the lecture, which is related to image classification and analysis. For processing the satellite imagery, usually it goes through three main pre-processing steps. First steps of geometric corrections, which are needed to ensure that image in a time series overlay properly. Then the second step is cloud removal. And the third step is radiometric corrections, which are in particular recommended to make change interpretations easier by ensuring that images have the same spectral values for the same objects, from the same homogeneous spectral objects. Here we show how an example of geometric correction, how the GLS Global Land Survey dataset, Landsat dataset, corresponds has already good geometric accuracy. Presently, this global land survey data sets exist over the years 90, 2000, 2005, 2010, and more recently 2015, with only limited some quality issues in some part of the tropics when there is a high cloud coverage or seasonal issues. All Landsat data from the USGS archive are available for free since the end of the 2008. And these datasets can be used as baseline datasets, as reference datasets for image geo registration. The next slide shows an example of radiometric and atmospheric corrections. For radiometric corrections, requirements vary depending on the classification methodology. Sophisticated and automated approaches require radiometric correction to calibrate spectral values to the same reference object in multi-temporal datasets. This is usually done by identifying a water body or a dark object and calibrating the other images to the first image. The image contamination by haze is relatively frequent in tropical regions. Therefore, where no alternative image is available, the correction of haze is recommended before image analysis. Topographic normalization is recommended for mountainous environments from a digital terrain model. The slide here shows a chain of pre-processing, an example of processing chain from for Landsat image, in this case for sample based for sample units. In this specific case, the approach does not require general atmospheric correction, but merely normalization of the image requiring two different time steps over the same area. The chain starts from a top of atmosphere calibrated image, then a tassel cap based haze reduction is performed. This is followed by the basic forest mark recreation, which is subsequently used for normalizing the spectra value of image acquired in different at different types. Then at the end, all these steps, the images are ready for multi-temporal segmentation and subsequent qualification, which will be detailed in the next slides. So for analyzing the processed satellite data, many methods exist to interpret images. The selection of the best, most appropriate method depends on available resources and whether image processing software is available. Whichever method is selected, the results should be repeatable by different analysts. What has to be noted that it is generally more difficult to identify forestation than deforestation, because forestation occurs gradually over a number of years, while deforestation occurs more rapidly, as easier to detect and to see. Finer spatial resolution, additional field work, and accuracy assessment are required if forestation as well as deforestation needs to be monitored. The main types of available methods for processing of 30 meter resolution data will be listed in next slides, with a few important aspects of how to select the approaches. So this table gives a list of different methods, main methods available for analysis of 30 meter type of resolution satellite imagery. The slide categorizes the main methodological approach for analyzing satellite Landsat type of imagery, ranging from point-based visual interpretation to segment-based automatic interpretation methods. The principal area of use, as well as the main advantages and limitations, are also briefly described in the table. The choice of the most suitable method for a given situation is based on several issues as described in the other sections of this lecture. The visual scene-to-scene interpretation of forest area change can be simple and robust, although it is a time-consuming method. A combination of automated methods like segmentation and classification and visual interpretation can reduce the workload. Automated methods are generally preferable where possible because the interpretation is repeatable and efficient. Even if using a fully automated process, the visual inspection of the results by an analyst which is familiar with the region should be carried out to ensure an appropriate interpretation and an appropriate accuracy assessment of the reference of the results. The strength of the visual or the purely visual delineation and interpretation is that it allows the utilization of the local knowledge, even in the case of no or limited technical image analysis capabilities. To improve the repeatability and to make the process faster, visual interpretation can be automated with automated pre-processing steps. Some more details are given now in the next slide. The image segmentation is a process of partitioning an image into groups of pixels that are spectrally similar and spatially adjacent. The boundaries of pixel groups delineate ground objects in much the same way a human analyst would do based on its shape, stone, and texture. However, delineation from automated segmentation is more accurate and objective since it is carried out at the pixel level based on quantitative values. The segmentation for delineating image objects reduces the processing time of image analysis. And the delineation provided by such approach is not only more rapid and automatic, but is also finer than what could be achieved using a manual or visual approach. It is repeatable and therefore more objective than a visual delineation by an analyst. Using multi-date segmentation rather than a pair of individual segmentation is justified by the final objective of the for the Red Plus, which is to determine change in forest areas. This slide shows an example of the result of semi-automatic multi-date segmentation and classification. So we have in the middle the result of the segmentation from two Landsat images, and on the right the illustration of an automatic land cover classification. It has to be noted that with this approach, land cover, which has changed over the observation period, in this case between 90 and 2000, will form separate segments, separate objects. A few points on the digital classification of the image segments. Two supervised object classifications are easier to produce separately on two multi-date images instead of applying a single supervised object classification on the image pair. A standard training datasets for supervised classification, including sample sites of all the desired classes, can be created using an exhaustive sample of training sites from the remote sensing data that is used in the analysis. ALFU unsupervised clustering is also possible. For large areas, it is recommended that supervised object classification to be applied with a training phase beforehand and a labeling correction validation phase afterwards. The multi-date segmentation followed by supervised classification of individual dates is considered more efficient in the case of a large number of images. This slide here shows an example of automated classification of segmented image using a land cover signature database. So you have on the left the segmented image and on the right the example of the automated classification based on a signature database. It has to be noted that this is only the first phase of the classification. The initial classification results, which are displayed on the right, will subsequently pass through a second level of correction of the labels and validation phase. These slides present the basic idea of deriving forest cover change estimates utilizing the classification approach presented in the previous slides. So using from the multi-temporal segments, each epoch image, in this case year 2001 or 2005, is first separately classified. Then the final classification are then overlaid and a change matrix can be created. It is important to highlight that due to the multi-temporal segmentation, the segment borders match perfectly in the two images and the change areas are outlined as separate segments. Given the heterogeneity of forest spectral signatures and occasionally poor radiometric conditions, the image analysis by the skilled interpreter is indispensable to map land use and land use change with high accuracy. So there's a need of visual interpretation, verification. The interpretation should focus on change in land use with interdependent visual assessment of the two multitemporal images together. And scene by scene, it means side by side interpretation, it's more accurate than interpretation of image mosaics, particularly when there is a lot complex cloudy images. The spectral, spatial and temporal characteristics of the forest have also to be considered during the interpretation, in particular in the case of seasonal forest, as a minimum requirement since from the same period season of year should be used when using a multi-temporal interpretation. This slide shows an example of a tool for visual validation and interpretation, which was used by GRC and FAO for the forest cover change analysis related to the remote sensing survey of the forest resource assessment carried out under the FRA 2010. Section four, of this lecture will cover the issue of accuracy assessment for activity data. As basic concepts of an accuracy assessment, first, uncertainty is an unavoidable attribute of practically any type of data, including forest area maps and forest area change estimates. The proper manner of dealing with uncertainty is fundamental in the IPCC and UNFCCC context. The IPCC defines inventories consistent with good practice as those which contain neither over nor underestimates so far as it can be judged, and in which uncertainties are reduced as far as practicable. Accuracy assessment of the activity data, it means of the estimates, it means of the forest area change, is an essential part of the process of reducing the uncertainties involved in the entire REDD+ process. Some main aspects of accuracy assessment will be highlighted in these next few slides, but more detailed technical details can be found in the GovSeaGold sourcebook and in the GFY methods and guidance document. This slide shows an example of the visual appearance of a 30-meter Landsat image on the left compared to a 4-meter resolution satellite image, COMSAT, on the right. It's aimed at highlighting the great difference in the level of detail between these two satellite imagery. The very high resolution datasets like COMSAT can be used to perform accuracy assessment for interpretation conducted using Landsat type datasets. We have to be noted that the very high resolution datasets available in global datasets like Bing Maps or Google Earth may also be used full reference for interpretation conducted from coarser resolution data. However, attention needs to be given to the timing of the acquisitions of the datasets so that the very high resolution data used for accuracy assessment should match temporally to the Landsat dataset similar which has been used for the forest cover mapping. Some considerations for the reporting of the activity data. The monitoring should work backward from the most recent reference point to use the highest quality data first and then allow for progressive improvement and methods. More reference data, more reference accurate data are usually available for more recent time periods. If no forward accuracy assessment is possible or practical, it is recommended to apply the best suitable mapping method in a transparent manner. At a minimum, a consistency assessment, it means reinterpretation of a subsample in an independent manner by regional experts. Such a consistency assessment should allow some estimation of the quality of the observed land change. Finally, the next few slides will illustrate some of the major limitations of using satellite data. Alfuh observation satellite imagery is extremely valuable for forest area monitoring. Some crucial limitations need to be always taken into consideration. The major limitation in large-scale multi-date projects is typically the availability of high-quality observation. Issues like cloud cover and haze, combined with the temporal frequency, greatly limit the actual availability of usable satellite observations. Second, regardless of rigorous pre-processing routines, atmospheric conditions and topography cause variation in reflectance values, on which classification and interpretations is largely based on. Furthermore, there's always a trade-off between the spatial resolution and coverage. Compromises need to be made. Finally, there are issues related to comparability of remote sensing data and the results which are derived from them. This is particularly important in relation to the historical context. These slides illustrate the issue of cloud coverage and present the mean annual cloud cover, and which highlights that the level of cloud denies in the tropical and subtropical countries. In many of the humid tropical countries, the mean annual cloud cover is above 80%. And this slide presents an example of the actual availability of Landsat cloud-free observations over sampling sites which are 20 by 20 kilometer size and which are located at the coordinate confluence for target years 90 and 2000. Alfuh, the nominal observation frequency of the Landsat images is every 16 days. The actual availability of usable scents is dramatically less, especially in the humid areas, in the humid tropical areas. You can note from this slide that the image acquired during the target years 90 and 2000 are a clear minority of all images used for the epochs. This is especially the case for the 90 epoch. For the 2000 epoch, the situation is somewhat better. Nevertheless, even in 2000, with a full year observations, less than half of the sample locations could have been covered with usable data. In summary of this lecture, the IPCC guidance and UFC decisions are providing the general guidelines that should be used for developing national forest definitions and monitoring approach for REDD+ activities. Numerous remote sensing data methods can be used to monitor activity data for forests, and preferably it's recommended to use multi-date image analysis, supervised repeatable classification approach, and visual verification and rigorous accuracy assessment on the resulting maps. Even with the known limitation of satellite observation, remote sensing is indispensable for monitoring activity data for forests in tropical countries. The exercise in the separate presentation, some country examples of Brazil, India, and Democratic Republic of Congo are provided with exercise using Landsat time series data to derive forest area change estimates. It is also recommended, so other modules as follow-up are recommended, in particular module 2.2, which looks at monitoring activity data for forest, remaining forest. It means monitoring forest degradation. For module 2.8, which is giving an overview and status of evolving technologies, including in particular radar data. And for modules 3.1 to 3.2, to learn more about RED Plus assessment and reporting. A few references are reported here as examples of the methods which have been approaches which have been illustrated in the previous slides. And finally, it remains to thank you for listening to this lecture so accurately.